of a strong and perfect plea. A great high priest whose name is love, whoever lives and pleads for me. My name is graven on his hands. My name is written on his heart. I know that right in heaven he stands. No tongue can bid me then depart. No tongue can bid me then depart. Satan tempts me to despair and tells me of the guilt within. Upward I look and see him there, who made an end of all my sin. Because a sinless Savior died, my sinful soul
Good morning, St. Andrews, and welcome to our first service of 2022. Thank you for joining us in this online church service. It's a pleasure to spend this morning with you. Well, as with the last few years, our plans for starting this year just don't look like we'd hoped, do they? I'm here in an empty room with not even a tech team with us today. We're trying to stay very COVID safe over these next week or two, just as the dust settles after our Christmas services. But it's just another reminder, isn't it, as we change our plans and see our plans kind of fall apart, perhaps over Christmas or New Year, whatever it was for you. It's right that we remember again that humans' plans have always been changed and thwarted by all kinds of things. There's only one who makes plans that could never be changed or thwarted or undone, and it's the Lord our God. I've been reading some of the Psalms just over these last few days. I had a couple of days just anxiously waiting some rapid antigen test results and whatnot, and I found myself rereading some of these comforting psalms. Psalm 33 starts by encouraging us to rejoice, to sing a new song to our God, to play the 10-stringed lyre, and though I won't be doing that anytime soon, it tells us to shout for joy, and then it gives us some magnificent reasons why, even in some unsettling times. Let me read Psalm 33 from verse 4 to verse 11 to you. For the word of the Lord is right and true. He is faithful in all that he does. The Lord loves righteousness and justice. The earth is full of his unfailing love. By the word of the Lord, the heavens were made, their starry host by the breath of his mouth. He gathers the waters of the sea into jars. He puts the deep into storehouses. Let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the people of the world revere him. For he spoke and it came to be. He commanded and it stood firm. The Lord foils the plans of the nations. He thwarts the purposes of the peoples. But the plans of the Lord stand firm forever. The purposes of his heart through all generations. Well, if anything, our generation is one that knows the heartache of plans that have been thwarted or purposes that have been foiled by whatever it is. And perhaps it's of our generation to keep coming back to these words and finding the peace and the hope within them, that the plans of the Lord will stand firm forever. They cannot be moved, like that picture we see in the New Testament of the house built on the rock rather than the sand. And that his purposes, the ones of his heart, of his unfailing love, it's those purposes that will be seen throughout all generations. Friends, I hope you know the peace that comes with knowing the Lord our God, whose purposes can never be thwarted, even as ours may be. It's right that we gather, even if from afar, to worship this magnificent God, to sing a new song to him, to rejoice and shout for joy. And that's what we're going to do this morning as we sing together, as we hear his word read, and as we have it unpacked by Stu in a little while. It's good that we do so as we come under his plans and his purposes that are better than ours anyway. Why don't I pray as we start our service in this new year? Heavenly Father, we thank you so much that your plans can never be thwarted, that yours are the ones that will stand firm forever. We thank you that time and time again, whenever it looked like your plans would be brought awry by the purposes of humans, that you have always and will always be in complete control. We look back and see the Israelites year after year in slavery. We see them pursued by the armies before the Red Sea and thinking, what will you do now? Lord, as we see them exiled and dispersed after their kingdoms are lost, and as we see your son on the cross, it could be so easy to think that your plans could be done away with. But Lord, you've worked your greatest works through exactly those moments. And we pray that as your people yet again come to you with thwarted plans and with purposes that have been foiled, Lord, would you do your work with them? Would we choose your plans and not ours? Would we find in our heart and your purposes being grown? Lord, we do echo your son's words that your will be done and not ours. We bring before you our holidays and our families, our expectations for this year, and we say, Lord, your will and not ours. We pray all this in your son's mighty name. Amen.
I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. Forevermore, for endless.
Well, friends, let me bring you some church news so you can stay up to date in the life of our church family. We've just finished the end of Matthew chapter 4. That kind of finishes off a little Christmas mini-series in the book of Matthew that we've been doing. And next week, we stay in the book of Matthew, but we're skipping ahead a few chapters. We're going to be kicking off in chapter 11 and looking at the gospel of the kingdom. We're going to see more and more this magnificent ministry of Jesus from his beginnings to really the middle of his ministry. We can't wait for you to join us. Next week, we're looking at these great expectations that people had of him and how truly poignant it is in this season that those expectations often aren't met in the way that we expect them to be, are they? Well, please stay up to date through our weekly news. Our newsletter will be a little bit more on hold than usual, given that it's January, but we will be putting out YouTube video news as needed throughout January. We do want you to stay up to date with where we're at, but our plans is still to go ahead with our summer services, 9 a.m. and 6 p.m. Be there online in the morning or at either service in person, but if that changes, we will let you know. Over this summer series, it's right that we continue to support and pray for our various mission and aid partners. We love that we get to bless the world through the ministry that we do in this place, both in prayer and financially. And so continue to give throughout this Christmas season. I have no doubt that whatever impact Omicron is having on our lives, it can feel much bigger and even harder in other places of the world. Our rural communities, our third world countries, where a bunch of our missionary partners are serving, I can't even imagine how difficult it's been. So it's so good that we can partner with them all throughout. Please remember that 10% of anything we gather, we give away. So please give generously. And finally, we have our John Dixon series coming up. We're very excited to hear from him yet again. We have two of his outreach series coming up this year, and the first is in that early February, March kind of time. So pop that in your diaries. We'll give out some resources for you to invite your friends with as we go along, but be praying ahead of that, that God will be growing disciples in this place, deepening our faith and adding to our number that he might be glorified.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene. And wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned, unclean. Singing how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. Sins and my sorrows, he made them his very own. He bore the burden to Calvary and suffered and died alone. Singing how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. Savior's love for me. And with the ransomed in glory, his face I at last shall see. It will be my joy through the ages to sing of his love for me.
Love for me, how marvelous, how
Saviour's love for me.
The Bible reading is from Matthew chapter 4. Matthew chapter 4, beginning at verse 12. When Jesus heard that John had been put in prison, he withdrew to Galilee. Leaving Nazareth, he went and lived in Capernaum, which was by the lake in the area of Zebulun and Naphtali, to fulfill what was said throughout the prophet Isaiah. Land of Zebulun and land of Naphtali, the way of the sea beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. The people living in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has dawned. From that time on, Jesus began to preach, "Repent, for the kingdom of the heaven has come near." As Jesus was walking beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon called Peter and his brother Andrew. They were casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. "Come, follow me," Jesus said, "and I will send you out to fish for people." At once they left their nets and followed him. Going on from there, he saw two other brothers, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John. They were in a boat with their father Zebedee, preparing their nets. Jesus called them, and immediately they left the boat and their father and followed him. Jesus went throughout Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, and healing every disease and sickness among the people. News about him spread all over Syria, and people brought to him all who were ill with various diseases, those suffering severe pain, the demon-possessed, those having seizures, and the paralyzed, and he healed them. Large crowds from Galilee, the Decapolis, Jerusalem, Judea, and the region across the Jordan followed him. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Hi, St. Andrews. It's a bit of a pity we can't all be together for church today, but in these challenging times, we do, of course, need to take our health very seriously. Perhaps you're holidaying somewhere nice, or perhaps you're stuck at home for a period, whatever your situation is at the moment. I want to encourage us all right now to turn our attention to the Lord Jesus and to his word to us in Matthew chapter 4. Will you put aside whatever else is going on for you at the moment, and will you pray with me that God would speak to each one of us now? Dear God, we ask that you would focus our hearts and minds on you and on your word. Help us set aside the apparently urgent and help us concentrate on your eternally important word. Amen. And today we're in the second half of Matthew chapter 4, and we're looking at the second half of Jesus' declaration of his mission. This whole chapter sets out what Jesus has come to do very clearly and publicly. If you missed the first half of this, you could jump over to the St. Andrew's website or YouTube channel where I've recorded my Boxing Day sermon on Matthew chapter 4, verses 1 to 11. So you could do that, or you could just catch up on it a little later. Either way, what we saw in the first half of Matthew 4 is that Jesus has come to break the power of Satan over humanity. Now, how do we know this? Well, as soon as Jesus is formally commissioned for his ministry in Matthew chapter 3, as soon as his baptism with the Spirit identifies him as God's Son, the first thing that he does is go into the wilderness. He doesn't first launch a campaign at the Jerusalem temple or set upon the failed religious rulers of Israel. Instead, he prepares himself in the wilderness and then battles Satan. The priority that Jesus gives this encounter indicates, before all others, Jesus' mission addresses a spiritual problem. It overthrows a spiritual enemy. Jesus has come to us in order to overthrow Satan and destroy the power of evil and death. But what we've observed is that he does this in a distinctly human way, in humble dependence upon God and his word. That's the first thing we need to know about Jesus' mission from the very first part of this chapter 4. And now I think what we've got before us today is the continuation of Jesus' mission announcement. What more can this involve? Well, we're going to find out by reading the rest of Matthew chapter 4. Now, Jesus' mission is carried out in a certain setting, a setting which has a few components to it. First of all, there's the timing. Verse 12, when Jesus heard that John had been put in prison, he withdrew to Galilee. So John the Baptist's imprisonment by Herod Antipas triggers the formal launch of Jesus' mission in the northern parts of Israel. A little later on in his gospel, Matthew provides details of John the Baptist's ultimate fate. But for now, he's just held in jail. And what's significant here is that Jesus' mission begins in earnest immediately after John's ends. After the Elijah comes the Messiah, filling the prophecy of Malachi. A second, the setting of Jesus' mission also has a geography. Verse 13, leaving Nazareth, he went and lived in Capernaum, which is by the lake. The lake Matthew refers to here is more commonly the Sea of Galilee, the Sea of Tiberias. Since Capernaum is just 14 kilometers along the shore of the lake from Herod's palace, Jesus is hardly running away from him. Instead, Jesus' early ministry is going to take place right under Herod's nose, but for a particular reason. Back to verse 13. Leaving Nazareth, he went and lived in Capernaum, which was by the lake in the area of Zebulun and Naphtali, to fulfill what was said through the prophet Isaiah. Land of Zebulun and land of Naphtali, the way of the sea beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles, the people living in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has dawned. So the geographical setting of Jesus' mission is going to begin in the territory of two of the ancient 12 tribes of Israel. In the geography of Israel, this was the very northern part of the northern kingdom of Israel, which split away from Judah and Benjamin in the south, with its capital in Jerusalem. Now, of course, Matthew is primarily interested in the fulfillment of the prophecy from Isaiah chapter 9. At some point over the Christmas season, you've probably heard Isaiah 9 read out, you know, "For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders. And he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." So here, Matthew is quoting the beginning of this very same chapter in order to refer to the whole chapter of Isaiah 9. And as always, context is everything. So Isaiah 8 details God's judgment against the northern kingdom. They are to be cut off and exiled to Assyria. They will walk in darkness while God hides his face from them. And then, turning to Isaiah 9 verse 1, which is in the original, begins with a but. Nevertheless, despite their disobedience and judgment, God will reveal his great light to those of the northern kingdom, those of Naphtali and Zebulun. No more gloom and spiritual darkness. They will have joy because the Lord has freed them from their oppressors. The war will be over because unto us a child is born, and the government will be upon his shoulders, and so on. So putting together all that Matthew's saying here about the setting of Jesus' mission, it begins immediately after John the Baptist's ministry finishes. The Messiah follows after the Elijah-like prophet. And it begins in the northern part of Israel, hinting at the reunification of Israel, northern and southern kingdoms together, even touching the Gentiles of Galilee. And it fulfills the promise of God's Wonderful Counselor and Prince of Peace. And so it's against this backdrop, in this setting, that we are to understand Jesus' mission. And with this in view, in verse 17, Jesus now steps forward to declare his mission. From that time on, Jesus began to preach, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." This is just the briefest summary of Jesus' preaching, but it carries huge significance. What does Jesus' ministry mean for Israel? In short, he announces that the kingdom of heaven has come near, therefore repent. First up, we notice that Jesus sees his mission primarily in terms of the kingdom of heaven. He doesn't use words like salvation, justification, or redemption nearly as much. Instead, Jesus spoke about the kingdom of heaven in his preaching and teaching over and again, such that we should understand everything he did in terms of God's kingdom. So let's dig into this a bit more so we can see why it's so important. We usually talk about being saved from our sins so that when we die, we'll go to heaven instead of hell. But this is not the way Jesus talks about his mission. Yes, his mission means that we will be saved from our sins, but that's only one part of something much bigger, something actually much greater. So much so, I'm going to say that until we grasp Jesus' kingdom mission, we'll struggle to live well as a Christian. You see, since the beginning of the Old Testament, God has promised his chosen people would rule in his image as his representatives over a land that was fertile, peaceful and prosperous, the Garden of Eden all over again. This kingdom, this expression of the rule of God, was everything that Israel was supposed to be, God's people living in God's place under God's rule. So God's glory, majesty and honor as the true and living ruler over all that he had made was to be on display through this kingdom. In fact, God would personally live among his people in his kingdom, just as it was in the Garden of Eden. Of course, Israel's repeated failures throughout the Old Testament called that into question, but the promise remained. The exodus from Egypt, the giving of the law, life in the promised land, the reign of Israel's kings, the preaching of the prophets, even the exile into Babylon, all of these pointed forward amidst the failures, assuring that God's purpose would not be thwarted. The prophets promised that when God's Messiah arrived, he would bring in this kingdom. Justice would truly be served. Everything would be put right. God's people would sincerely live in a way that honored him and carried out his plans. So when Jesus preaches that this kingdom has come near, that it's arriving with him, the significance of this could not possibly be lost on his hearers. More than just their personal salvation, going to heaven instead of hell, Jesus is declaring that the purposes of God in all creation are now coming to fruition. The renewal of all things is at hand. The way back into the Garden of Eden, or something better, seems now to be opening up. If we skip ahead to the end of the chapter, to those verses 23 through 25, that's exactly what Jesus is demonstrating. So verse 23, Jesus went throughout Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and healing every disease and sickness among the people. News spread about him all over Syria, and people brought to him all who were ill with various diseases, those suffering severe pain, the demon-possessed, those having seizures, and the paralyzed, and he healed them. The prophet Isaiah pictured the rule of God in these physical and tangible terms that we could kind of quickly latch onto. He wrote, you know, no more tears, no more pain, no more death. Instead, actually, a banquet, a party on God's mountain, that is, in his personal presence. So here's the thing for us to grasp today. Jesus has inaugurated this kingdom, soon to be fully realized. If you're a Christian, you have entered into this kingdom. You're living under the rule of God, along with all the people of God. He's present with you. You live to reflect his glory and majesty. His ways, his will, his purposes, and his priorities are now also yours. You've got a role to play in extending and displaying this kingdom. The angels in heaven look on to see it, because without the church, they couldn't know it. The believers who have gone before us are only complete when we join them in their acts of faith and joyful obedience. Christians, we belong. We're at home in this kingdom that spans eternity, this kingdom in which the entire cosmos, all of time and space, are brought together under the headship of Jesus Christ. Now, we can see how this is so different to the mindset that says, you know, well, Jesus came to die to forgive my sins so I can go to heaven. That framework, it's much too small. If all I do is accept an offer of forgiveness so that a transaction takes place where Jesus dies in my place, then what do I do now? If that's all that Jesus came to do, what else are we supposed to do while we, you know, wait to die? Not so much, it would seem, of value anyway. But when we view Jesus' mission like this, it's easy to see what a small view of life we end up with. When we see that Jesus' mission was to bring the kingdom of heaven and that we're now members of that kingdom, suddenly everything opens up. Yes, he did die on the cross for us and our sins are forgiven. Praise God for that. But now we have entered his kingdom. What we do really means something, something enduring and worthwhile. Our daily acts of compassion and care for others display God's love. Our simple acts of service display Christ's character and bring him glory. Our work, whether it's volunteer work or paid work, whether it's recognized or it's just overlooked, our work is done in the image of God. Our creativity reflects God's creativity and brings him glory. Our diligence and perseverance displays his commitment and enduring faithfulness. This is just part of what it means to be made in his image, to embody his rule over all creation, to begin to show God to his creation. Now, as members of God's kingdom, then, this fear of missing out is no more. FOMO is dead. Now, one of the challenges this past year has been the thought that we're missing out on something, missing a holiday or missing out on family or that special relationship, missing out on that job opportunity or whatever else. This fear of missing out cuts deep when we think that life is passing us by and kind of slowly fizzling out into meaninglessness. You know, the premise underlying FOMO is that the only good we can enjoy is what we can grasp right here and right now, because that's all there is. But if we're members of God's kingdom, not only is the best yet to come, but right here, right now, God has important and valuable work to do both through us and in us. We have opportunity, God-gifted opportunity, to care for others in their challenges, to bless them, to genuinely empathize, to grow in our own Christian character, to remember and to give thanks for our many blessings, to become more of the person that God always intended us to be. More like Jesus Christ. I'm no great horticulturist, but I'm told that many trees do their most important growing in the wintertime. You know, when conditions are cold and bleak and when the leaves have all fallen from the branches. The growing that is so important is the growing of deep roots, unseen, below the ground. These are the roots that will nourish the tree when the spring arrives and fruit begins to show. That will draw the water from the deep below the surface when the summer droughts come. And they will hold the tree secure and strong when the winds of autumn are blowing. What we're saying is that even if your life feels like a barren tree in winter, God is at work. Actually, this is the way God's kingdom is. He's always at work in his people and through his people. And what he's doing matters into eternity. I know we've gone off onto a bit of a deep dive in this idea of living in God's kingdom, but we want to grasp the significance of what Jesus is preaching here, of what it means and what he means when he says in verse 17, the kingdom of heaven has come near. The arrival of God's kingdom is what the cosmos has been waiting for. All creation has been groaning in anticipation. At Jesus' first coming, it was inaugurated. It was the official launch. And now we live in the tension with God living among us in the person of his Spirit, awaiting the culmination and the fulfillment of that kingdom. Then God will permanently live with his people in all his triune splendor, Father, Son, and Spirit. But even now, since the kingdom of heaven has come near, the only right response is to repent, to change our entire way of life, to rethink every part of our behavior. Repentance has many avenues. Look, if we need to turn from unbelief back to God, we've got that opportunity now. That was Jesus' message then. Repent, because the kingdom of heaven is at hand, and it remains the same today. Well, now, quickly glancing at the remainder of chapter 4, it's actually now going to make a whole lot more sense. Why would Peter and Andrew, James and John abandon their jobs and their families and follow Jesus? Doubtless it was not the first time they'd met him, but when Jesus declares the arrival of God's kingdom and when he's looking for workers to go out and fish for people, why would they settle on a small life with little weight? The kingdom of heaven is at hand. What does it mean that Jesus heals the sick and casts out demons? It means the kingdom of heaven is at hand. This is the lens that Matthew gives us to make sense of Jesus and his ministry of preaching, teaching and healing and calling disciples to follow him. As we begin this new year of 2022, we've got no idea what kinds of challenges may lie ahead for each of us. But what we do know is that God's kingdom is on the march. Our membership of the kingdom of heaven is the frame to everything, the only frame large enough, significant and valuable enough to anchor us in the secure and loving purposes of God. May 2022 be a year of rich kingdom blessings for you and those whom you love.
Hi everyone, it is lovely to lead you in prayers today, this very first service that we have in the new year. I know for many people that as we begin a new year, it is a time to actually start afresh in our faith and in our walking with the Lord. We're beginning our time of prayer with a time of confession, which of course is communal. But because we're watching online together, you have the opportunity, if you'd like to pause now and to do some of that reflection on the year that's been and to confess more specifically, personally today, if that's what you'd like to do. Knowing that God forgives you and that by his Holy Spirit, he refreshes and cleanses you and empowers you to live for him. And so it's helpful, isn't it, to contemplate the year that's been and hand over the year that's coming to God. And so let's confess together now. Feel free to pause if you'd like some time. But the words are on the screen and we're going to confess together. Together. Merciful God, our Maker and our Judge, we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. We are sorry for all our sins. Father, forgive us. Strengthen us to love and obey you in newness of life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Merciful Lord, grant to your faithful people pardon and peace, that we may be cleansed from all our sins and serve you with a restful mind through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Well, as we continue to pray, let me lead us. Father, we pray to you at the outset of 2022 that you would bless us for the year ahead. After another year of uncertainty, we've been reminded that the ultimate blessings you bring are the assurance we have in Jesus, that we are saved in him and have a good purpose in this life and a hope for a glorious eternal future. And so in these things we pray, please continue to bless us. Help us to continue to trust you in all things and be ready to share your love and blessings with others in need. We especially bring before you people significantly impacted by COVID, our frontline hospital workers, those involved in testing centres and the incredible workforce behind the scenes. Supply for their every need, we pray, and sustain them during these periods of high demand. For those who are sick, please limit the impact of the virus. For those who are isolating, be their comfort and strength. And for all of us learning to live in this new normal, give us the calm of your peace and the wisdom of your Spirit. For anyone managing to have a holiday over these next few weeks, please give them the rest that they need before tackling work and school. And as many face the disappointment of cancelled plans, please, in your mercy, give them the spiritual rest and refreshment they also need. It's easy with so much news of COVID to lose sight of all else that's going on in the world. And while we certainly ask that you minister to our needs in that way, We ask that you would help us to not lose sight of what else is going on around us. Help us to remain generous and to keep at the front of our thoughts a readiness to love our neighbours, whoever they may be. With that in mind, we pray for all of our mission and aid partners and thank you that through them we might partner in gospel ministry in the wider regions of Sydney and around the globe. We also pray for our youth camp later in January and ask that you would help ensure that it goes ahead if it's safe to do so. These young people need the experience of fellowship in this way, so please, we pray, help them to be able to gather with each other around your word. Bless the camp preparations and go ahead of this precious ministry. We thank you that you hear our prayers. And so we leave these and all other things on our hearts and minds today in your hands.
We're now going into the Apostles' Creed. So I just ask you to join with me as we say this together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Well, thanks, Neil. Friends, we've now come to a time where we're going to celebrate the Lord's Supper together. So if you're prepared at home, if you want to get the elements ready, whatever you're using for the bread or whatever you're using for the wine or grape juice, have in front of you there. Reminded of these words from Matthew 11:28, that Jesus said, "Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." Or from 1 John chapter 2, verses 1 and 2, that if anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Well, friends, with these words ringing in our ears, we're reminded that we don't always live God's way. And so let's use this time as we're together here on the online to confess our sins together before our great God and King. Let's pray this together. Merciful God, our Maker and our Judge, we have sinned against you in thought, word and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. We are sorry for our sins. Father, forgive us. Strengthen us to love and obey you in newness of life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Well, we're reminded, aren't we, from 1 John verse 1, 8 to 9, that if we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, he who is faithful and just will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Well, friends, knowing this, why don't we take a moment and pause for self-examination, and then I'm going to invite you to pray with me this prayer of humble access. Friends, let's pray this together. Gracious Lord, we are not worthy so much as to eat the crumbs from under your table, but your love compels us to draw near. We come with repentance and faith to express our need in the benefits of your Son's death for us. Renew us in your service and help us to love one another as members of the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. In the Father's tender mercy, he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death on the cross for our redemption, who made there a full, perfect and sufficient sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. And on the night he was betrayed, Jesus took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And likewise, after supper, he took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. Amen. Well, friends, for those at home, if you want to take the bread or whatever you're using for bread at home, and I'll say some words and we'll eat together. We'll take and eat this in remembrance that Christ's body was given for you, and be thankful. And now if you'd like to distribute what you're using for grape juice or wine, let me say some words and we'll drink together. Drink this in remembrance that Christ's blood was shed for you, and be thankful. Well, friends, to conclude our time of the Lord's Supper, let's pray together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours. Now and forever. Amen.
Glory and power to the one who loves us. Honor and praise him forever. Come, Lord Jesus. Come, Lord Jesus. Glory and power to the one who freed us from all our sins by his blood. Come, Lord Jesus. Come, Lord Jesus. See him coming on the clouds of heaven. Every eye behold him now. He's the living one, the first and the last, who once was dead, but now he lives. Servants, come, Lord Jesus. Come, Lord Jesus. See him coming on the clouds of heaven. Every eye behold him now. He's the living one, the first and the last, who once was dead, but now he lives forever. Is Almighty Lord, who was and is to come. Jesus is the living one, who died and came alive. Jesus is Almighty Lord, who was and is to come. See him coming on the clouds of heaven. Every eye behold him now. He's the living one, the first and the last, who once was dead, but now he lives. See him coming on the clouds of heaven, every eye behold him now. He's the living one, the first and the last, who once was dead, but now he lives.
Well, thank you. you guys so much for joining us for this service this morning. I know it's never the same being at home, alone perhaps, or with your families on the couch, but it is good that we can still hear the word of God proclaimed, isn't it? You know, I often think of Paul sitting in a jail cell one or multiple times throughout his ministry and not being able to gather with his people, but still in his epistles feeling so connected to his church family. And that's certainly how I feel in these moments, that you very much are our family, connected by our spirit, unified into one being on our cornerstone of Jesus. And even though we are far apart, how God might use us as that unified church body. Well, the sky is the limit, isn't it? So whatever the next few weeks brings for you, I pray that God's plans for you may never be thwarted, which we know they won't be. And I pray that you might know the peace and the grace that comes from that in your daily lives. Can't wait to see you next week. We'll hopefully be in person, but we'll keep you up to date with all the news and we'll see you then. Thanks, guys. Bye.
Strong and perfect plea, a great high priest whose name is love, whoever lives and pleads for me. My name is graven on his hands, my name is written on his heart. I know that he stands, no tongue can bid me thence depart, no tongue can bid me thence depart. When Satan tempts me to despair and tells me the guilt within, upward I love.